In our first episode, we looked at the rise of Osman Gazi, who would go on to become the first ruler of the Ottoman Beylik in Bithynia, which was situated on the frontier of the once powerful Byzantine or Roman Empire. The House of Osman he founded would soon grow in power and regional prestige, taking advantage of the plight of the Byzantines and expand their lands even to the shores of Europe in the process. The Ottomans had made Sote their capital and would over the next two centuries move it multiple times. Orhan was born in Sote and would retain it as the capital of the Beylik as well. Upon his father Osman's death, Orhan became the de facto leader and sultan of the Ottoman Beylik. It appears that Orhan was not a ruler hungry for power. Some future rulers would abuse their power as sultan and look for ways to always accrue even more. Orhan, however, was said to have proposed to his brother Aladdin that they share the rule, but that Aladdin declined, saying he did not wish the empire to be divided. Instead, it is said, he opted to accept as his share only the humble revenues of a single village near the city of Bursa. It would be a rare exception of peace between two brothers, one of whom was sultan. For later sultans would not view their siblings so favorably, and we will cover that in future episodes. Orhan would instead make him his vizier, which in their tongue meant bearer of burden, from the Arabic word wazir. He would go on to make some instrumental and important changes that would benefit the empire for centuries to come. During their father's reign, the military was comprised of armed vassals and volunteers. It was not a professional army, which meant experience was variable as they would be dismissed at the end of each campaign. The process of forming a professional army would have its foundation laid down during Orhan's reign and with Aladdin's input. An army not seen since ancient Roman times and one not repeated by a European power for another 100 years. There is debate about how much influence was exerted by Aladdin and how much Orhan sought from him, but most agree that his brother's influence was responsible for the creation of a standing army of regular troops. There is debate, however, as to whether or not the fabled Janissaries were created during his time or the later Sultan Murad I. Orhan would fulfill his father's dream of territorial acquisition. If we look at the political situation he faced on his borders, it's possible to see why the Byzantine lands became his primary target. On his borders, to the south and east, sat the more powerful Turkmen principality of Germion. The Byzantines, though, had lost considerable power and influence in the region since cresting their zenith. While they still controlled lands outside of the fabled and ancient city of Constantinople, it was only the city itself that really provided defensive certainty. Their remaining lands stood more as a tribute propped up by the illusion of what once was, rather than what currently was. They were but a pale shadow of their former selves. We get a glimpse of Orhan as a leader through the eyes of a visiting Ibn Battuta, who was touring the emirates of the region in the 1330s. He described Orhan as the superior of all Turkmen emirs in terms of land, army, and wealth. We also have evidence of Osman's growth via marriage alliances, struck, for example, with two of his neighbors, a dervish and a Christian Tekvur. Tekvurs were autonomous Christian leaders in the region. Many of these would, after a time, convert to Islam. He also brought in aspiring youths from different parts of Anatolia who joined under his banner. Then there were raids which produced slaves, some of whom would go on to become trusted members of his chieftainship. One such slave was said to be Balabancik, who would be assigned important duties during the upcoming siege of Bursa. Orhan began his expansion in 1321. He first captured Mudanya, which sat on the Sea of Marmara. Mudanya was the port of nearby Bursa, so would serve in helping to cut off seaborne trade. He set about negotiating a surrender with Bursa, while one portion of his army, under Commander Konur Alp, captured Kocaeli province, and a second was sent to the southeast coast of the Sea of Marmara. Meanwhile, Orhan was able to negotiate the surrender of Bursa, long his father's dream, without lifting a sword. Although we can be fairly sure that the threat of the sword did play a role in the negotiations. We can't understate how much the Ottoman army incorporated a variety of troops into its ranks. One example comes from the negotiated capture of Bursa itself. Its previous Byzantine commander, a man by the name of Evrenos Bey, who had become a commander of a light cavalry squadron serving under Orhan. His sons and grandsons recorded as having continued to serve the Ottomans during their lifetimes. Next for Orhan was the capture of Byzantine coastal towns along the Bosporus coast. The Byzantine Emperor Andronicus III viewed Orhan's expansionary actions as an affront to the empire, and one which he would not tolerate. However, the Byzantine army he would raise was not comprised of professional troops as in centuries past, but rather it was, as with the army that Osman had fought with, made up of many mercenaries. On the 10th and 11th of June, Andronicus would meet Orhan in battle. In just 40 years, the Byzantine lands had shrunk from much of modern Turkey to just a few scattered outposts along the Aegean Sea. In addition, they held some lands around Nicomedia within about 150 kilometers of Constantinople. While we still call them an empire during this period, they had in reality been reduced to the holdings of a city-state. The inevitable encounter between the former Byzantine superpower and the emerging Ottomans under Orhan would be their first major engagement. As Andronicus marched towards Orhan, his hope was to eventually relieve the strategically placed city of Nicomedia and Nicaea. In addition to these cities, he hoped to restore the frontier territory to widen the expansion of the Byzantine lands. His mercenary troops consisted of but 4,000 soldiers. With him leading the troops was the Grand Domestic John Catacuzini. They marched along the Sea of Marmara coastline towards Nicomedia. However, Orhan and his 8,000 men had camped strategically upon the hills that blocked the way to Nicomedia. And on the 10th of June, Orhan attempted to lure the emperor and his troops towards their hill encampment. He sent 300 archers to pester the Byzantines, who drove them off, not falling for the bait. Until nightfall, the two sides continued to skirmish, the emperor making preparations to retreat as soon as possible, as he knew that not only was the way to Nicomedia blocked, but his troops were outnumbered 2-1. Orhan was having none of it, and he blocked the Byzantines' repeated retreat attempts. During these battles, both the emperor and John Catacuzini were injured, although rumor soon spread that the emperor himself had died. This sapped morale during the retreat attempts, and soon it would turn into a rout, with the Byzantines incurring heavy losses from the repeated Ottoman attacks. Catacuzini then took the lead and took what was left of the mercenary army back to Constantinople via sea. The impact of the loss stung the Byzantines deeply. Never again would they attempt to regain territory in Asia, and the former imperial capitals of Nicomedia and Nicaea would not be relieved or maintained, as the crossing of the Bosporus was simply not possible. The city of Nicaea had been under Ottoman siege since 1328, but effectively blockaded much earlier, since 1301. The reason for the long siege: their inability to take control of the lakeside harbor, which was able to continually ferry and replenish food stores to the city. However, the city would, after 30 years in 1331, finally fall. With Nicaea falling to the Ottomans, but two Byzantine strongholds were left. The city of Nicomedia and Philadelphia, which was surrounded by the Germanids and would remain so until 1396. Andronicus III attempted to bribe Orhan to keep the city as a Byzantine holding. However, Orhan would not take the bribe and instead led a final attack that took the city in 1337. With Philadelphia surrounded, as mentioned previously, the Byzantines were effectively deprived of their last eastern holdings. The emerging Ottomans also implemented the foundation of their government, including no longer acting the vassals to the Seljuk ruler. Evidence for this was them no longer using his image on coins or his name during public prayers. In fact, this is when they would begin to mint their own coins. In 1338, the Ottomans captured Scutari, resulting in most of northwest Anatolia falling into Ottoman hands. 1345 would see a change in policy and resulting strategy. Orhan would take over the fellow Turkish principality of Kars'ı. There was a strict philosophy of war waged against fellow Muslims. Fellow Muslim countries or regions were considered abodes of peace within the framework of the religion, and a ruler would need a special pretense to take up arms against another kingdom. Orhan saw such an opportunity to intervene when Kars'ı's ruler died, leaving two sons who both claimed the leading title of emir. Each would take up arms against the other in what devolved into a civil war. Orhan positioned himself as a bringer of peace. His troops would descend on Kars'ı, pushing both brothers to the castle of their capital. One of the brothers would be killed and the other captured. Additional territories would also be annexed, and as a result, and of critical importance, it would bring the Ottoman territory to Kanakale, providing Orhan and the Ottomans with the Anatolian side of the Dardanelles Straits. Most of northwestern Anatolia and those once important Byzantine cities of Nicomedia and Nicaea, all now within Ottoman lands. What followed were 2 decades of relative peace in the Ottoman Beylik. Orhan worked on his brother's ideas to implement a series of civil and military changes that would put down further roots for the once nomadic people. Mosques would be funded and built, as would schools, dervish lodges, charitable institutions, and other public buildings and works. The only military venture of note was the annexation of Ankara, which had been in the possession of a commercial religious guild by the name of the Ahis. The beyliks that had been left in the wake of the defeat of the disbanding of the Sultanate of Rum still bickered amongst themselves, leaving themselves open for future conquering. He created a melding of cultures, at least initially, that helped expand the Ottoman Empire's influence and became an emerging initial characteristic of the Ottoman Empire, for some of the conquered peoples would find themselves with more rights under their new ruler than they experienced under their old. Orhan would go on to develop peaceable relations with his former adversary Andronicus III during this peace, a peace that would extend to his successor as well. However, internally, there would not be peace for the Byzantines. The irony being that while there was peace with the Ottomans between the years 1341 and 47, the Byzantine Empire itself would descend into civil war and chaos, squandering its last resources in the process. Byzantine's young successor, the 8-year-old John V Palaiologos, would, led by his regents, wage war with John VI, Kantakouzenos, a Byzantine general. The general would have those 6 years of fighting and emerge victorious, take over the rule of what was left of Byzantium, the former Eastern Roman Empire. The Byzantines had become so weak that the Italian maritime city-states ran the real commerce of the region. Indeed, both the Genoese and the Venetians would begin to figure prominently in the politics of the region. The Genoese possessed Galata across the Golden Horn from Constantinople. They would fight the Byzantines in 1348 when they had lowered custom tariffs to lure trade to their side. Opinions vary on who got the best of the conflict, but we know that by 1352, the Genoese and Venetians would enter into conflict amongst themselves. The Venetians had sent a fleet of ships to destroy the Genoese ships stationed in the vicinity of the Golden Horn. In response, the Genoese bombarded not only the Venetian ships, but the walls of Constantinople itself, prompting the Byzantines to side with the Venetians against them. While the Venetians and their new allies would build a fleet to engage the Genoese, it was the Genoese ships who would come out on top. Orhan and the Ottomans supported the Genoese during this conflict. In response, he sent an auxiliary force across the straits to Galata and their Genoese allies. During these political maneuvers, Orhan's son, Suleiman Pasha, captured the castle of Sinbi, which would give the Ottomans a permanent stronghold for the first time on the European side of the Dardanelles Straits. The Emperor John VI tried to negotiate with both Suleiman and Orhan directly to vacate the city and castle, but this was met with either rejection or outrightly ignored. Orhan was now in his 70s, and frequently ill. His last years would be sad family-wise. In 1356, his son Khalil, whom he'd had with his Byzantine wife Theodora, was abducted somewhere on the Bay of Ismet by a Genoese commercial boat captain. He entered into talks with now emperor and brother-in-law John V, who sent a fleet to where Khalil was being kept and paid a large ransom to bring him back to Ottoman territory. Then, in 1357, Orhan's eldest son, Suleiman Pasha, would die from injuries sustained falling from his horse near the coast of the Sea of Marmara. It was said that the death of his son further weakened the elder Orhan, and he would die just a few years later in Bursa in the year 1362, almost reaching the age of 80. He had reigned for 36 years and headed a stable expansion that saw the empire with two capitals, first Sot and then Bursa. Another of his sons, though, Murad, would reign as Murad I, and we will cover his reign in the next episode. If you enjoyed this episode, please hit that like button, share this podcast with those who you feel have similar interests. If you enjoy this channel but haven't yet, please consider subscribing. Love to have you on board. Till the next video, and as always, cheers.